Welcome to the Garden Angelus, where we talk about flowers, veggies, and all the best dirt. I'm Dee Nash from Guthrie, Oklahoma, where I garden on 7.5 acres out in the country.
And I'm Carol Michael from Indianapolis, Indiana. I have a suburban garden measured in square feet. I garden on less than 1/3 of an acre.
We call ourselves Garden Angelus because we are evangelists for gardening. We love gardening and we want others to love it too.
Yes, we do. And we aren't afraid to spill the beans and tell all of our gardening secrets, the good, the bad, and even the ugly. But that's enough about who, what, when, why, where, how. Let's move on to this week's episode. Hello, Dee.
Hey, Carol, how's it going?
It's all good. I have to tell you, I gave you an assignment last week. Did you do it?
Not exactly, but I did do some looking up of information. There's a lot of ways you could take it. Tell them what my assignment was.
Well, your assignment was to come up with a list of plants that you would include in a garden that was dedicated to the memory of the first ladies of the United States.
Yeah, and what I discovered is that would be one varied garden because our first ladies liked a lot of different flowers.
Yes, I did a little looking up too, and you can find roses, irises, daylilies, azaleas.
Peonies. Who liked azaleas?
I don't know. I just looked up plants named after first ladies, and there was a list, and it had a bunch of azaleas on it.
That's weird. So some of our first ladies loved the color white. And Nancy Reagan loved white peonies, and she was always being told by her florist, her White House florist, that you couldn't get peonies in spring at the time. You can now because of hothouse growing, but back then you couldn't. And so that was a big thing because she always wanted white peonies in winter and stuff like that. Michelle Obama liked bright colors, but I didn't find where she liked one particular flower. I'm going to say that she probably likes sunflowers, and here's why. Vegetable garden. Remember Michelle Obama's vegetable garden?
Yes.
Okay, so what looks great in a vegetable garden?
Sunflowers.
So since she liked bright colors, and since they incorporated sunflowers in some of their decorations, I'm going to say that Mrs. Obama liked sunflowers. She is not the only first lady that liked bright colors, though.
Really? Who else?
Laura Bush. Laura Bush likes orange roses. So it's especially appropriate that Jackson and Perkins created a rose for her that's orange floribunda. And it's called Laura Bush. So if other people like orange roses, there you go.
So you did a lot of homework for this, Dee.
I did. When my internet wasn't working correctly, I went and did a bunch of homework on it on my cell phone.
You know what's interesting? I actually went to a program about 2 or 3 years ago that was put on by a retired White House florist.
Fun?
Did we talk about that at this podcast? I don't know that we did.
I don't remember that, no.
Well, it's a story for another day, but he worked for the Clintons and the Bushes. And retired shortly after the Obamas came. But he had some fun stories with all of them.
That's neat. Did he say anything? I didn't find anything about Hillary Clinton's favorite. Did you?
No, but he said that he was very gracious in regards to every single first lady that he worked with. And said he had no problems with any of them. So we'll put that on tap for later this winter. How about that?
That sounds really great. I want to say one more first lady, Lady Bird Johnson, who...
Oh, the queen of the flowers.
The queen of the flowers. She is a hero to me because of her work with native flowers, wildflowers in Texas and throughout the U.S. She wanted us to emphasize that, and we could do a whole episode on her sometime, but her favorite was the Texas bluebonnet, which is a lupin. Lupin texensis, I think. And so I grow bluebonnets in my pasture, and I just bought more bluebonnet seed. So there you go. I did do a little bit of research on this. We could do a whole podcast on the first ladies and their flowers. That would be fun.
We could. We might do that this winter, maybe in February around President's Day.
That would be a perfect time.
So while you're talking about seeds for your pasture, tell me about your garden this past week.
Well, there's not much going on in the garden, really. There's something beeping in my kitchen as we're talking, so I hope it stops. Not much is going on except for I sowed lettuce and kale and radish seeds in the veg pod for the fall garden, and I need to pull up my cucumbers, and I'll need to put down some shredded leaf mold if I'm going to plant some more seeds there, because as we know, cucumbers are heavy feeders, as is lettuce and other leafy greens. So I think I'm going to have to increase fertility by putting some shredded leaf mold on there. So I grew a lot of stuff in that little garden this year, and it kind of needs a rest, or it needs more stuff. And I harvested honey. So I've been a little busy.
You have been busy. And we're going to talk about your honey harvest. I think we're going to talk about that in more detail next week.
Oh, we are. Okay.
Yes. I made that up. So I have flowers that are starting to fade, and I just saw the first toad lily bloom, and the toad lily's kind of late summer, early fall flower, so I definitely know that fall is coming. My honey locust tree is starting to drop a few little leaflets, so and I am ready for September, and I said I need to gird my loins, so to speak, for the big push in September, because there's so much to do to get the garden kind of over the next hurdle and ready for winter. And we're going to talk about some of that next week, too, digging in dividing perennials.
Right.
Plus, I've seen a lot of cicada-killing wasps hovering around, and I've seen some of the holes that they dig over on the side of the house. So I posted about those on my blog, and my best insect picture ever, Dee, was
Oh, I didn't see that post. Wasp. I need to go look.
Yes, the cicada-killing wasp on top of a cicada. It's actually stinging it.
Ooh,
the picture is kind of old, but I like to I like to bring it out every couple of years because it's a good picture.
Yeah, it's a good picture. I have seen that picture. I remember it now. So once again, they won't go after us. They go after cicadas. And unless one flies up your dress, you're not going to get stung by it.
Correct. And we've talked about my sister had, never mind.
Yes.
She had that.
She got stung, but it was because she was wearing something and accidentally flew up there and got upset. Speaking of stinging insects, I think my honeybees were mad at me today because I took some honey from them yesterday. And I was trying to pick some green beans out there from some other green beans I sowed. And I had a honeybee, and she just wasn't having it. And I'm not even close to their hives. But if people think that honeybees don't remember, yeah, they do for a few days. And so I came inside because she was very upset with me. And she kept buzzing around in my hair. And if they get inside your hair, especially if you have curly hair, you're going to get stung on your head. So my hair isn't that curly, but I came inside anyway.
Good idea. Speaking of bees, reminds me of flowers, and I have a quote about flowers. Are you ready?
I am.
The delphiniums I planted in my ignorance have all bloomed like everything and are getting ready to bloom for the second time. And Mother says the ladies of the garden club come over each day to worship and grit their teeth. Eudora Welty.
Is that actually from, is that from a book she wrote, or is that from, that sounds like something out of a novel she wrote.
It is, no, it is,
it's a part of her gardening stuff. Oh, how funny.
It's from a book we're going to talk about called Tell About Night Flowers, Eudora Welty's Gardening Letters, and we'll talk about that more, but it's from a letter that she wrote somebody. And you can just imagine, you know, you get a really special flower or something, and it, people come over and grit their teeth because it's not in their garden.
Right. Because delphiniums are not the easiest thing to grow.
No. And they're not even the flower we're talking about this week.
No, they're not. But I can see why the garden ladies were coming over to worship and grit their teeth. Because I saw some really fine delphiniums in England. And they were all trussed up to their little stakes. And they looked fabulous. I can't grow them here, so it just made me laugh. So what are we talking about today?
We're talking about another perennial called Allium Millennium. And I would suppose that people were gritting their teeth because I posted about these in mid-August. They were in full bloom in my garden, and people were like, I did not know alliums could bloom this late in the season. And I just have tons of them.
Did you deadhead them earlier season? Or
nope.
Have you never deadheaded them? So mine bloomed early, my Allium Millennium. But mine are new plants, and I've got them facing the street. And the younger plants, the smaller clusters, bloomed really early. And then I deadheaded them, and they didn't do anything else. The bigger group, which I found at another place, it's a long story, they bloomed once. I deadheaded them, and they're blooming again now. Isn't that interesting?
I do not believe it is interesting. The Allium Millennium that I have is not a rebloomer. It blooms once for several weeks, and then the flowers kind of fade to a silvery gray.
Yeah.
At which point, you know, they don't look terrible. You could leave them because they aren't rampant self-sowers like their relatives, the chives, are rampant self-sowers. And if you leave chive flowers to go to seed, you're done. But they don't. And I will go out there probably next week and just deadhead the whole bunch of them. Because I literally have tons.
So here's my theory about mine. I suspect that the big pots of them aren't reblooming. I think they're successively blooming. Is different. Having never grown them until this year, not alliums. I've grown alliums before, and they really don't like Oklahoma. But Allium Millennium, I've grown two seasons, and I mean, I started it last fall, and then it's gone on here this year, so I guess a season and a half. It's done really well. We'll see how it does again in winter.
That's good.
But it should be cold hardy, right? Because it's cold hardy where you are.
It's very cold hardy. It's the 2018 perennial plant of the year.
Mm-hmm.
I planted mine, it'll be 3 years ago this fall. So they've been through two complete growing seasons.
Okay.
I planted them in the fall of 2018.
You couldn't find them here for a while. I bought some from High Country Gardens in the spring, and they shipped them here, and they were little. And then it turns out that Bustani Plant Farm also had them in much bigger containers. So those are the ones that are still blooming, the ones from Bustani.
So I will say this. A lot of the big, like the drumstick alliums, I don't think of those as the things that bulk up, and so one year you have one, and the next year you have two. But Allium Millennium, I would say, is more of a it clumps.
Mm-hmm.
And so it'll produce a lot of bulbs. And I actually had a friend give me two big clumps of it in the fall of 2018. He had had them in a container. And then I just lined them up along the edges of some flower beds.
Yeah.
And they have bulked up in 2 years, and I'm ready to share and divide, and all three of my sisters want more of them.
They're really pretty. They're short. We should talk about that they're short. That's why you put them at the front of the bed.
Yes.
Right?
They're short.
Right. Unlike the big alliums that are tall. So shorter, bulk up, great plant, easy to grow. What else?
It is a hybrid.
Yes.
And when it was registered, they spelled it Millennium with one N instead of two. And so it is misspelled correctly.
Oh, I did not know that. That is weird.
Yes.
Well.
And once a plant gets registered with a name, you can't just go in and say, oops, I misspelled it. So it will be ever misspelled correctly as Millennium.
Instead of two N's. Interesting.
Exactly. Yes. And that's just, it just happens. So.
Yeah.
Are you ready to move on to veggies?
Oh, we should say one more thing about it.
What's that?
Deer do not like it.
No.
Deer
do not like it.
That's why it's planted at the front of my bed that is facing the street, because when I get deer pressure, that's where I get it. And so I put Millennium on the end of that, both of that side of that bed. And you know what? They haven't liked it, and they don't like coleus either, and they don't like pink muley grass. So, all good things.
Very good things. I'm going to read you another quote.
Please do.
I was born with the feeling that if time and hurry were forgotten, something quiet and wonderful would happen in their place. Eudora Welty again.
Do people see a pattern here?
Perhaps.
Advice from Eudora Welty, because we like her.
Since I'm going to call this episode Channeling Eudora Welty in the Garden, I think they're going to figure out.
So I think I know why you picked this quote.
Yes.
Because you and I have decided to quiet our lives and slow down this summer.
Yes.
And in doing that, we learned a lot of things about our gardens, and we had more time to do things we really wanted to do, like read books and
exactly
stuff like that. So let's talk about how quiet and wonderful the garden can be if you're not worrying over every weed.
Right. It's quiet and wonderful if you're not worrying over every weed. It's also quiet and wonderful if you're not worrying about taking pictures that you want to put on Instagram or Facebook, and you're just out there enjoying the garden.
In fact, I've not been taking my phone out with me in the garden unless I'm waiting on a call.
Right.
Because there's a tendency to quit doing what I'm doing and look at my phone. Even though, although less so now because there's not anything on my phone to look at.
Right.
But I might want to take a picture. So what I have been doing, because I do still take pictures of my garden and I blog and have newsletters and just like you do. And so I come back out with my big camera and take pictures.
That's nice. I was just going to say, I have a big camera. I have not used it in a long, long time. I probably need lessons on it. But anyway, that is good to take a camera out and just use it to take pictures.
Yes, but not near the beehives right now because they would be unhappy with me. Also, if you don't have a garden, you might consider getting a membership in a CSA, Community Supported Agriculture. And the reason we bring that up right now is...
Now is the time that you would want to get subscribed because they would like to get money ahead of this actual season. Because based on the number of subscribers they get, that tells them how much seed they should get and how much that they should plant.
Right. And a lot of those CSAs, they work with... In fact, I want to link to this one that we both go and look at on YouTube occasionally. It's two millennial gardeners.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's Honey Acre Farm.
Yes, I enjoy
and
those videos.
And you can, they do CSA and they also do, I think they do CSA. I'm pretty sure they do. And then they also go to the farmer's market. And the work that they put into that little farm is really something to see, even if you just skip around in the video. So that's why you go ahead and subscribe right now. And also here, there's a really good one that is in Oklahoma City, actually in the Nichols Hills area, that is run by a friend of mine, and it's Guilford Gardens, and she has a CSA. And if you don't subscribe right now, you don't get to subscribe a lot of times because she is very busy.
Yes, and they will only... take a number of subscribers that they can actually support.
Right. And so they can only, it's a limited number.
Right.
So if you want good food and you'll get to try lots of new vegetables that you've never eaten before, like maybe Swiss chard and kale in the in the early spring or in the fall.
Right. Because they do try to have as many fresh vegetables as far into the end of the season and as early in the season as they can manage it with row covers and things like that. So that is a good option right. If you don't have a garden, a CSA.
So we wanted to highlight it this week.
Yes.
Because honestly, we just didn't think of a vegetable we wanted to talk about. So we just talked about a bunch of them.
That's right.
And slowing down. So can I do the next quote?
Please do.
Gardening is akin to writing stories. No experience could have taught me more about grief or flowers, about achieving survival by going, your fingers in the ground, the limit of physical exhaustion. Eudora Welty. That is so true.
That is true.
I think gardening will take you to the very limits of physical exhaustion, especially once you do it a lot. And survival by going... you know, just piece by piece.
Right.
And that's the same thing when you write. You have to write it piece by piece. And that brings us to our bookshelf, which we have two books this time.
Right. We have One Writer's Garden, Eudora Welty's Home Place by Susan Haltom and Jane Roy Brown. And we also
I have too.
I have that book. My copy mm-hmm. is signed by Jane Roy Brown, who I've heard speak a few years ago. And then mm-hmm. Tell About Night Flowers, Eudora Welty's Gardening Letters, 1940 to 1949, selected and edited by Julie Eichelberger.
Huh. I don't have the second one, but I'm intrigued. And I don't know if you'll know the answer to this. So it's a quiz. Why does she say tell about night flowers?
That is one of the lines from one of the letters that she was had written to somebody, and she was talking about the the night flowers. And, you know, there are special breeds of night flowers that bloom at night. Like, we are both growing flowering tobacco, which is a night flower, heavily scented at night.
Right. It blooms during the day, but the scent doesn't happen until late afternoon. Another one would be moonflower. There's a bunch.
Right.
4 o'clocks. I just talked about this in my blog, actually.
Well, and she had some friends, and they called themselves, and I don't have the exact title for it because I didn't think, but the Serious Garden Club, and it was C-E-R-E-U-S.
Mm-hmm. Oh, after the night blooming cirrus.
Because everybody had one, and if yours was getting ready to bloom, you know, the word went out, and all the neighbors, it was a social occasion to stop by and see the night flowers blooming, the cirrus.
Ah, got it. Because it doesn't bloom very often. You have one.
No. Well, if you put it outside and give it better care than I'm giving mine, it will bloom reliably. Mine is just, I keep it just, you know, like this side of death. It's not very healthy. My fault.
And it's a tropical, isn't it? So it wouldn't be hardy where you live.
Yeah.
In fact, I think when I went to see her garden, because I went to her house because you told me to go there because I was driving by it in Mississippi. Isn't it Mississippi?
Yeah, Jackson, Mississippi.
We go through this every time. Yeah, Jackson. So I think they had it in the garden.
Yeah.
But of course it wasn't blooming.
Yeah, it was summertime. And if you had a, you know, a conservatory type room, or if you lived in a warmer climate, you could probably keep it protected enough in the winter in a porch or screen porch or something like that. But anyway, when... so Susan Haltom, she actually interviewed Eudora Welty, we'll call her Miss Welty, in the 1990s. And, Miss Welty lived in the house that she grew up in basically until she died, and she's like 92. And so Susan came in and they talked about the garden, and her intent was to help it somehow get restored. And so, Miss Welty told her, don't make this garden something it wasn't. And so it's really fashioned as a suburban garden between 1925 and 1945, which was when her mother had the garden. And she always considered it her mother's garden. Yes, Chestina.
Yeah, she called it her mother's garden, not her garden, even though she's famous. So, and we should say why she's famous. She's not famous for gardening. She's famous for writing these wonderful Southern novels that evoke family life. I would call her kind of the Jane Austen of the South, although Jane Austen fans would think that was bad. But it's that same type of writing, although they aren't romances. She wrote The Optimist's Daughter, didn't she?
That's the one she won the Pulitzer Prize for, was The Optimist's Daughter. Mm-hmm. And I've decided that I can't remember reading it, so I actually have it on hold at the library. Because I spent all day...
It's really good.
Not all day yesterday, but I spent... quite a bit of time yesterday looking at stuff on YouTube, and they have interviews with Susan Haltom and with Jane Roy Brown, and also the photographer that photographed the garden for the One Writer's Garden book. And then I listened to a talk given by Julia Eichelberger, who wrote the gardening letters. And Miss Welty was going to destroy all her letters.
She was, yeah.
And
like Jane Austen's sister destroyed hers.
But she didn't. She ended up that a lot of the letters that she had written to other people, those people had kept them, and they donated them. And I think the University of Mississippi has archives of all her letters. You know who else she wrote letters with, Dee?
I don't remember.
Elizabeth Lawrence.
Oh, I knew that. Yeah, we had talked about that before. So... I'm sure that was quite the conversation, because Elizabeth Lawrence loved to write to people, and they probably talked about their gardens, didn't they?
Yes, and then if you look in the book, One Writer's Garden, there is a lot of references to Elizabeth Lawrence. And I decided, you know what, I think I haven't read that book word for word. You know, I've looked through the pictures and got a sense of the garden, but I decided that I'm setting that aside to read. And I've read Tell About Night Flowers. I read that all the way through, and I thought that's worth another read. So, and the Optimist Daughter. And then here's a trivia thing for, do you know what? Have you ever heard of the Eudora email client back in the early days?
I can't get a word in. I don't know why you're asking me. I can't get a word in edgewise. No, I have not heard of that.
Well, back in the early days of email, people used a client called Eudora. Uh-huh. Do you know why they used a client called Eudora to do email?
No, go ahead.
Why? Well, the developers knew that she had written a short story called Why I Live at the Post Office.
I've read that short story.
And so the main character in there is always referred to as Sister. So based on that, they decided to name that first email client Eudora, after Eudora Welty.
Oh, that's cool. That's really cool. So when I went to visit her garden, I also found out that she's not only a writer and a gardener, but she was also a photographer. And one of her favorite things that she liked to take photographs of were graves at graveyards. Because, you know, the South has really interesting graves and sometimes above ground and stuff. And there is a book, and I can't remember the title of it now, but there's a book of her pictures of the graveyard, and I own it. And it's really, she was quite good, and she took pictures back when it was hard. Also, they've encapsulated the house and garden at 1989. So the garden's actually a little earlier. And then the house is set at 1989, and her typewriter sits out just like as though she's getting ready to type again. And she never used air conditioning in that house.
No, and they did
and
add
it. She lived to be 92. They added it now, thank goodness, because I don't want to walk through that house with no air conditioning.
Yeah, she didn't like air conditioning, so she'd sit out on the porch when it was hot with the fan running. But I would like to go visit it, and someday maybe I will go down to Jackson, Mississippi, and I will see the house and garden. But they just show stacks and stacks and stacks of books all over the place.
There you go. I think we've talked about that enough.
You think?
Shall we talk about our gardening commission?
Yes, this is a new segment where we're going to give ourselves an assignment each time. And so we have a very interesting assignment this time, Dee.
Yes, from one of our listeners who wrote us this really nice email. I hope you wrote her back.
I didn't write her back. Did you write her back?
No, she wrote to you.
No,
so
she wrote to the garden angelist. It was both of us.
I think she talked more to Carol. But anyway, so her question, Erica is from Pennsylvania, and she wants to plant flowers that represent her kids who have moved away and use the flowers as a way to connect with them and to share with them over time. And so here's her question. My question for you is, are there a few perennials that you can think of to recommend here? Of course, each flower has its own personality, and some have more variety in types than others. I know this is a crazy question. No, it's not, Erica. But if you had to pick your top 5 to 10 perennials, what would they be? Of course, I could Google this and come up with a list of top best perennials, but it would mean so much more meaningful if recommendations came from you. I was out in the garden yesterday, and I thought of one right off the top, and I'm not going to say what it is because we're going to do that next week.
That's right. We're going to come up with 5 to 10 perennials that we would use that we think are very good perennials.
To represent children.
Yes.
Yeah. And I can think of several to represent my children personally, but that would represent anybody's children or the neighbor down the street or anybody that you wanted to kind of memorialize in some fashion in your garden. And I think we all do that to some extent, you know, because we plant things that our grandmothers planted or our dads planted or whatever. And so this is a kind of a reversal of it. You're actually doing this for your children. In fact, I just thought of another flower too, so... there.
And you're not going to tell anybody.
I'm not telling anybody until next week.
So that's our gardening commission for next week. We are going to list some flowers, some perennials for our listener, Erica, and we thank her for emailing us. And I will email her back.
Today. Yeah, that good idea.
We're on it.
I mean, we've been thinking about it for ever since she sent the email. I just don't want her to think that we didn't respond. And then on top of that, if some of our listeners also want to come up with some perennials or annuals that they think would work, please do.
Yes, and email them to us at The Garden Angelist. So with that, we want to thank everyone for listening to The Garden Angelist. If you like our podcast, please tell your friends about us.
And if you listen on Apple Podcasts, and many of you do, we'd love a 5-star review. That helps us get noticed by others. Plus, while you're there, hit that subscribe button so you don't miss a single episode.
Yes, and be sure to check out our show notes for links for more information about today's topics, plus links to our own websites, plus our email address, thegardenangelus@gmail.com, so you can send us your perennial suggestions.
It was lovely to chat with all of you over the garden gate today. Bye until next week.
Bye.